starts an error, so it's going to cut the auto Python analytics. Which is our classical machine learning library. Now we've made it a lot easier to use, and we've added distributed. Then we'll start with deep learning framework. Things like, based on the conversations I've heard around the software side, important part of that, how to get them, how to get the accelerations, sources available. Get past that of marketing, the legal movement we put in here. Just to orient you guys, hopefully you remember showed the slide before the interview and talk. This is the same work that the NN fits, and today we're talking about. The flow of method, MXNet, ABL is our own Spark-based framework, PyTorch acceleration available. FA2 is merged with PyTorch. These are all available. We have a page where you can get them. We also work with the data science team directly. And this should be available already in beta. All our course presentation, you can get to them. Running's off everywhere. I apologize for the photo, except the lot of my lines are going to go far in rapid images. But this is what Intel defines as machine learning and deep learning. It's controversial. Everybody has their own definition. I'm not too important getting into it. I want to call out that this is what we're going to discuss in the first part of this talk. Classical machine learning, or the rest of machine learning, will be discussed in the second part of the talk. Detailed discussion of the same thing, right? So deep learning is putting together a bunch of layers, the hidden layers in the middle, input data, connections everywhere. None of our calculations have to be done. You might have tens of thousands of calculations, and you have output data. A lot of times this is used for image segmentation, image recognition, all the things you guys heard about. I hope I'm getting into in your work. This is now, at least at Intel, we're calling this classical ML, which is a very funny idea because machine learning is very modern. We're calling this classical ML, everything that's not deep learning. We have a library called DAL, purpose of this library. This first part is just going to be the deep learning side of things. I'm probably preaching to the choir, but this is why it's important, right? So, in the past, human beings did much better at predicting, let's say, an image, what it was, than the computer. But over time, the computer is approaching the same error rate. We can plot for a lot more images in the same amount of time for the computer than a better human eyes and brain. Natural that we want to put some calories into training these faster, inferencing with them faster, and the job done quicker. This is where it's hard. So this right to left is increasing in year, and the error rate drops. Makes sense. You get better and better network topologies over time, but the depth just rises and rises and rises. So that's how we're getting there, making deeper networks. That means training takes longer. Each pass through the network. This is why it's hard. This is why it's important to focus on auto time to training. Intel has a scalable processor. You guys are all aware of it. You work with it. We are targeting new release directly towards deep learning in some way, shape, or form. So it's on our radar, and we're going after it. Look at the marketing ad, very glossy. A little bit of hardware side of things. This is the philosophy that, the overarching themes that Intel is working on. So we want generational improvements, continuous software optimizations. We very much believe in inferencing of their integers. And then, of course, scaling efficiency, because at some point, you can't go any further without scaling your. This is what we're targeting all of our scalable processors. And then, I apologize again. So, your machines have 512 instruction sets, so this is directly relevant to you. We added wider vector registers and instructions written directly for them. maps per second just rises as these values show. So we also added direct instructions for int 8. Work, as I mentioned, we're pushing pretty heavily on int 8. So if you were writing instruction level code, you have instructions directly for that. So this means that any library built on this uses instructions as well. It's very efficient. It's written by us directly to the for the architecture. This sort of summarizes the way that we're going forward, right? So we started with Skylake with FP32, some sort of value for an optimized cafe, then pointed over to analyze it. And we worked on software optimizations in the framework side, so we're working in cafe, raise the performance slightly. Then we add int 8 and raise the performance even more. We go to the next generation. This is not so relevant for coming out, but I'm trying to get the idea across, right? So we added a whole new instruction set inside our deep learning boost product. The instruction set's called V and I, so we just keep going in this direction. And now we're starting framework optimizations over here at the end of the slide. Keep going up in that direction. That's sort of the mentality of Intel right now. This is just trying to get home that we have worked on all these frameworks. So whatever your framework of choice is, we've these popular ones, at least, we have optimizations for you. Over the next year, TensorFlow and PyTorch are getting the most calories inside Intel. We launched Cascade Lake maybe a month ago, and there was good discussions internally about this, and the answer we decided on was PyTorch and TensorFlow, heavy work the rest of the year. If you're using those frameworks, they're working directly for you over the next 5 months. We go back to the how a network looks, right? So you have hidden layers in the middle, chain a bunch of layers together, a lot of times they connect nodes to each other after that. This gets ugly fast. You can get 10,000 connections, 100,000 connections easily. You look at it like this, it doesn't take much of a leap in your mind to know how ugly it gets and how hard it gets and how much computation is required. You want to train, you have to go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. We need to work on reducing time to train. This is, you guys are used to using the cluster, so I'm preaching to the choir here, but we like to call out when we give these talks that the clusters matter. We want to scale. We want to make sure everything we do is scalable. What's directly relevant to this group of listeners is that we don't need to sell you on using cluster computing, right? But Intel has settled on recommendations for these two frameworks. That's a distributed thing. If you're a cafe user, we recommend using RF scaling library in LSA. If you use TensorFlow, we recommend using Orvod. We work directly with them. I have contributor access to Google, so I can answer GitHub questions and I can make PRs and commits. So we are in direct communication and we know about it. We're working on it. It's as much as I can say, but we do know about it. And, we're taking all the actions we think we need to take to get there. Like this. So nodes are the same way you guys would use nodes, right? It's a machine of a couple of processors. This is also, I mean, this is one of those ones, almost when you look at NVIDIA's numbers, I'm just going to be honest with you. They ignore inputs and outputs, and they show going through some calculation to show they're faster than us. So this is done on TensorFlow 1.6. We have to build the source to get this. We work directly with TensorFlow to have a nice working version. You get our binary, then you get an early version. Now again, the hardware side, this is the framework direct accelerations. Yesterday I covered Intel VNN. And the slide, even though it's formatted differently, is showing the same what's inside Intel VNN. Hopefully this is familiar with it. So with that, we bring highly vectorized operations to the framework. Unbeknownst to you, when you use our TensorFlow, we will call in PRVNN code. And if you have an AVX 512 processor, we will get as hard as we can and utilize it to its full extent. It just happens under the hood. Framework side, I showed yesterday how there's performance considerations for using NPR Boolean. They have their own format, so you can boot to it and then stay inside NPR Boolean as long as you possibly can. The framework teams, one of their major jobs is to identify these chances for propagation and add them. If you used a TensorFlow, for example, and you run one of the models we've optimized, we'll pick off the graph that's been developed by the TensorFlow session. We will insert our own operations. So the exclusion graph will look like this after we pick it off. We'll do this under the hood. You don't have to do this yourself, but know that this is going on. So when you look at the reverse trace that I believe Paul introduced and I introduced yesterday, you see conversion, primitive, a reorder primitive, then there's a problem with the integration. And come to us for help. This is sort of stepping on Paul's toes, so I apologize that I didn't see a slide beforehand. But these kind of things need to be thought about. Runtime settings matter. So we optimize expecting you to have your runtime settings a certain way for our processors. And you want to get our accelerations, you prefer not to follow it. I will show a resource later that does this for you, so you don't have to memorize anything. We recommend them a nice web page that you can just go look for. Then we have this website, info.ai, that lists all the framework accelerations we have and how to get them. But since I work directly with your data science team, you can just get them how Paul recommends you to get them. That's how you should use them. Additionally, we have a site if you'd like to go read about it. How to get it? Refer to code. That's the same thing for Patrick, refer to code. That's the take-home message. Resources available. So I hope that this part sinks in because we are working hard to provide better support for these. We don't feel like you're on an island when you use our optimizations. I have many support channels for you now. First thing I'll do is plug this article. This is my name on it, so of course I think it's very helpful. But this is the one that was also in Paul's talk, Maximize TensorFlow Performance. But this is all the runtime settings that I mentioned. So each setting has a section to tell you what it is, what it's for, why it's important, when you recommend. You can just go read through this, learn about the settings that matter, and copy paste into your code. Here's the article. Basically, we have lots of questions happen over and over and over again. So I imagine if you sit down to use these, you'll probably have the same questions. We took all those and put them in the wrong article. We get into a TensorFlow setting, Paul introduced, data layer, why it's important, what we recommend. We get into Luma, KVNN. Many of the frameworks using KVNN, this section's relevant. So PyTorch is the same thing, you skip down to this section. Talks about what's important, affinity, block time, OpenMP number threads, and it tells you what each one of those is. Then explains all these terms so you're not confused, if you care to learn. If not, you can just copy-paste. Let me get back to the slides. I'm not a Mac person, so I'll press some different things and break through it. That's why they developed a program. We used to call this AI Academy, so maybe you guys have circled around and seen AI Academy. Here we have learning and teaching and all this good stuff. Since it was called AI Academy, there's lots of beginner material on there, and maybe that's not so relevant to this audience, but we have it up if you'd like to go check it out. I'd like to plug this form just as much as that article I just plugged. So this is a new form we have directly for the frameworks. It's monitored by engineers only. We don't have a team or actual support first front line. It's just engineers directly. Please use this. We want to build a board that people can come to and talk to and have a community. This is the title of it, so you should be able to find this on our form site, AI Framework, pretty straightforward. We have a builders program. This is not relevant to the people in this room, but the website is. So you guys will not be going into the developers program, but you can use the builders program website solution library. So whenever we work with an enterprise customer and build a program, we help them do something, we have the performance of some sort of problem they're trying to solve. We write a white paper and put it up there. You can read the white paper from the most recent builders. I wouldn't recommend applying to the program, but I would recommend putting it. Call to action, I have to show this. Move it. But look at all the things that I showed you. Questions on this question directly? It's not even talking about Python in general. Leave as many Python users in here for this hit you had. Of course, we know Python is just blowing up in the data science and machine learning side of things. Every year, it's on the rise, right? It's easy to use. So that's open source. These numbers are probably not a surprise to the people in this room, but this is not falling flat on Intel. We understand this. But we're working to make Python strip X teasers. We understand that Python users in the data science realm, let's say, have specific problems that need to be worked on. And I hate to say this, but software is slow, so a lot of times Python code is very slow. And if you're stuck on a single node or maybe a single small computer to start with, only a small portion of the data can be worked on. So basically, we want to remove the bottleneck, build out, raise performance, do all this for you under the hood without you having to think about it. So this is how we're looking at things. Python's up here, but high level, comes to an interpreter. Decode is native, hard, it's fast. It's a huge gap in between. And this is not falling on anybody's, going on under the radar anyway, everybody knows this, right? We use Python, it's very slow. The way to fix it is, use Python as a wrapper. Bring up the performance libraries, put them underneath Python. This is not, Intel doesn't want to do this, right? If you use NumPy from Anaconda, half the calls are going to drop down into C code and run, whether you know it or not. Otherwise, it's just too slow. This is what Intel's doing. We have fast math library in KL that Michael talked about. We have Bell, which is our classical ML library that I'll talk about in a few minutes. We have performance primitives. We have all these things. We hide them under Python now. So if you get our distribution of Python, we're doing all this stuff under the hood. We're replacing all Python layer functions with fast native code. Of course, because we know what processor is coming next, we're always working on the next generation. So if you get our Intel distribution of Python, we will have these performance libraries executing as fast as they can on your Mac. With some of the libraries we work on, we should know to most of the people in this room. We're really going for easy out-of-the-box access. So even though we have, for example, our own classical machine learning library, you don't have to use it directly because we're putting it in any cycling. So if you use cycling from Intel distribution of Python and the functionality overlaps with our classical ML library, we will pick off at the Python layer and we will call that from the C++ version of that. You just stay with scikit-learn as you used to. Drop and replacement, no change to code. Overarching theme that the Python team does, if there's any sort of change to code required, it becomes a big fight in terms. Bought into the open source environment, bought into the community of Python, trying to fit into that community, we're not trying to bring the community to us. Here's the marketing version of that. That's inside Intel's distribution of Python. Some new features. There's a couple, say, routes we're going down to try to address the distributed pattern, classical machine learning. That's what we've added in 2019. The first one is an easier-to-use Bell. We'll talk about Bell a little bit more direct in a few minutes. But if anybody here has ever tried to use it, Bell was basically the PyBell API was a copy of the C++ API. So you had to know how to write C code in order to use they've added this year is a new API called DataPod. And we shouldn't get applause for this. This is just, we should have done this in the beginning. This is a Pythonic API. So this feels like scikit-learn, those kind of things. It's a single line, it's easy to use. But now this is in. Why that's important is because PyDAL has nice support for distributed training. So because we have a single line API, we can turn on distributed versions of algorithms very easily. So it's an argument, distributed equals true, and you're ready to go. As I said, anytime we accelerate scikit-learn, we just basically throw DAL in action learn. The other addition is HPAT. This is, officially I believe in tech preview still, but we have a version that's just readily available. And what it does is it you have to change your code slightly, but it's just a single declarator. So if you add a declarator to NumPy operations or Pandas operations, we can, number one, distribute it for you if it's a distributable operation using MPI under the hood. Number two, if it's not distributable, we still accelerate it. So this allows you to use NumPy and SciPy calls that you're used to, or NumPy and Pandas calls that you're used to, but accelerate them. Pandas is fairly high rate. It slows a lot of things down, but it's so great to use, and it's so perfect for the data science realm. You want to fit into it instead of trying to put it away from it. So I'll show how to use HPAT in a few minutes, but that's the goal of it mainly, to plug into all the data munging that happens before model. That's anything you would do with NumPy before you plugged into scikit-learn, or anything you do in Pandas before you plugged into scikit-learn. Like I said, it's all targeting end-to-end for scaling. Get into much of this. I mentioned that a lot of times in video, we've done the same thing. So I guess I'm not attacking the video. We will focus on the model training for the inference. We'll ignore everything that's present, right? But if you're actually doing this, if you work at a company doing analytics, and it's going to be a manufacturing company, you'll spend most of your time messing around with the data and pre-processing. And then you have to sort of keep track of that data pipeline to apply all that pre-processing to any new piece of data or it's useless. This is very important. This is what we're going after with HPAT, trying to help speed up the pre-processing steps. Question before I move on to DAL and HPAT specifically. So, as I mentioned, end-to-end workflow scaling is what we're working on. That's what we're trying hard to add the 29th to our Python by the end of the year. The way we're breaking this up is data input and pre-processing on the left, and model creation and prediction on the right. This is the realm of Pandas, we hope. This side is the realm of scikit-learn, all the frameworks in Delta Pi. Now we're breaking it down, and that's why we have two new products that we're talking about. As I mentioned, on the HPAT side, it's drop-in, and you don't just import a new module, you have to change it slightly, but it's drop-in that it's just a decorator. You just add a decorator at HPAT, that's it. Ready to go. I'll show you how to do that. You just wrap it around it. And it calls, it uses number to JIT compile, so you're almost getting, you're basically getting jitting without having to do any of the hidden logic underneath it. On the Delta Pi side, we have this new API that I mentioned, single line, you turn on distributed by just passing an argument, distributed equals true. But we're also putting it underneath scikit-learn. So it's what we're working on basically both of them. On the scikit-learn side, you don't make any changes at all. You don't need decorator, you don't have to do any importing in new module. You just put your same code you ran before to Intel's Python, and you'll get that running underneath. This is a good selling point for most audiences, right? Because this is MPI under the hood without you having to do anything. But this is sort of an audience that probably wants to do stuff for self. I won't harp on this too much, but we are just calling MPI into this. This is a modified stack. Kind of complicated to read everything, I guess. But this is exactly what I showed before. There's the left side that's pre-processing, and the right side that's machine learning. There's such right here underneath the high level API and scikit-learn. You can use either one. If you want to scale, you'll have to use the FFI. We use, of course, we have our embedding library and math kind of all this stuff, but that's all happens under the hood. You don't have to even know that it's there, but I'm just telling you now that we're doing this. This is how HPAT looks. Find some pre-processing steps that you want to do to your data frame. Guys work with data frames, they probably don't work with anything else after that because it's so easy to use and awesome. Stay in Pandas. You write your Pandas code, put it inside a function, and decorate the function. If you want to distribute it, you would call AP run, MPI run, MPI exec. We will decide whether each one of these can be distributed or not, and then we will run it in a distributed fashion. If our logic that we've written into the code says us that the penalty is not worth it, breaking up the function we're trying to run, we just will distribute it. Then we just accelerate it locally. We're going to work on it either way. This is the scope. Again, it's in preview, but it's available as a conda install. I guess I'll only get discussed with the data science team whether we want to put the preview on theta or not. If not, you can just use the... These operations are already added. You should look familiar with people that have done data pre-processing in the past. And other stuff is already added. So this plot shows HBAT optimized pandas. Because it's so zoomed out, you can't tell that there's a speed up here. Optimized pandas on HBAT. So straightforward. But this is loading data in Pandas. Like I said, it's in release, major release later this year. We're targeting for 6 months from now. But there's already a working version app. We grab it from Panda and then give us feedback. We'll take it into account. The other piece to the puzzle is the DAL library that I mentioned. And basically, we wrote a fast math library in C++. Fortran. A few years ago, we tried to move it over to Python and we just copied the API. But it could use it because Python is not quite code that way at this time. So, this was the same thing we used to have. We'd say you have MPI underneath, you have TVB, you get all these nice accelerated operations and this proper programming underneath to run fast. But still, nobody used it because it was just too hard. So now we've added DAL for Pi and try to make that easier, right? And the one you can use is a monkey patch. So you can call Python, DAL for Pi, and then put your scikit-learn script, and we'll look for places to replace your scikit-learn. Or you can put it right inside the script itself, this dot patch sklearn. That's really no change to your code, right? The other way to do it is to load up Intel's distribution of Python, so your interpreter's calling the entire Python distribution we have. And you don't even have to do this. Easy to use, open message. It's data, multiple different algorithms and fitting. I'm going to go through them all, but you can imagine anything in running a native code is just going to blow away Python. Just showing that if you can run this in C, it's a lot faster. Use our Python, you're basically running C. This is speed up directly from DAL on K-means. Of course, the speed up is very high, it looks good. But now I'm going to show you how to do this, and I think you'll be impressed with how easy it is. So here's the DAL for Pi code. Load your data, create an algorithm. Cute. This will look very familiar to sklearn users. Pull out the centroids. Get your result. Maybe it's a couple more lines in sklearn, but it's very easy. To do this, you get the performance I showed in the last slide. No changes, just out of the box, ready to go. Nice. Distributed version is very similar. You know how to do this. Distributed analytics. Because the only thing you do differently over here. So distributed equals true. You use pair and PI when you write. Now you lose control, of course, because you choose one or the other, control or ease of use. So this is the ease of use wrap. We decide whether it can be distributed over the number of nodes you told us to, and then we do it, and we don't do it. But it's all done for you. This is how it used to be in Blur. So this is what it looked like 2 years ago. This is the C++ version, but the Python one is exactly the same. This would have been distributed payments. Again, we shouldn't be piling on the back. We should have had this in the beginning, but we did try to use Blur in the let down before. Give it another shot. That looks nice. This is what the scaling of the K-means code that I showed in the last slide. The code scaling, the important one here, right? So you can see that goes well with the number of processors. I don't think streaming is so relevant to this audience, or if you're an enterprise, or maybe continuously training, those kind of things. But I remember that we have streaming as well. It's very similar. Streaming equals true. You're ready to go. Very easy to use. This is an overview of the algorithms and contents inside there. If you wanted to know if your method of choice was in there. Prediction algorithms. So I used to be a practitioner, basically, before I came over to the software side. And I was in the fab, and I did actual predictive analytics. Processors that we were building. And random forest was our workhorse. I know that a lot of industry, random forest is the workhorse. Because it doesn't require a lot of tuning, it's fast, strong, powerful, doesn't overspit. But rest assured, we do have it. We have to call it decision forest based on legal discussions. But that's our random forest, if you're looking for it. This is the summary, right? This is it. Post the native performance and info there. That's the summary. So you get performance very similar to if you ran a C++ version of DAW, but in Python. And it's easy to use. It's pickable. Another problem we had before is we weren't pickable, and customers were very mad about that. So now we are pickable. That's in the scikit learning HPAT. Open source. I don't think you guys will be getting it from the GitHub, you'll be going through your data science team to realize it. But it is open source if you want to contribute to the code. HPAT how to get. So I mentioned that it's available for a Conda download. I put it in the slide in case somebody wants to reference my slides later. That's the install method right now, while it's still in preview. The call to action, again, I have to show this in legal. Team puts it in every presentation. But go check out all the things I just discussed. That's the call to action. Questions? So the question is, can you put more data that can fit into a single node? Right now, no. So Intel has a big DL library. That's why on top of Spark, I didn't cover it. Yes, so I guess what I'm getting at is we're not averse to Spark, so it's not a competition thing. But I don't think we're sticking around for